Okay, where we're going to be starting is on chapter 22. This is on page 375. The nervous system. Okay, age-related macular degeneration. This is, of course, one of the things that happens to folks' eyes, basically, as 22, page 375. You know, when the eyes, and the easiest way to me to figure this out is when I think of macular degeneration is just the eyeball inside, the workings of the eyeball is falling apart, is kind of breaking down into pieces. Oh, that's a test? Some folks will have these floaters, and I don't know if you have floaters or if you've had it yourself, but actually and it looks like a speck of dust. And at first, when you start to have them, you're not sure what they are because you're going like this. You think it's a gnat, but it's in the back of your eye, a chip kind of comes off the back, and in your eyeball it floats across your field of vision. Now, an older person is going to have a couple of those, but if they have lots and lots and lots, you know, they may need to go see the eye doctor. But, you know, a lot of times how you'll catch that is they'll be sitting there and kind of swatting like that, thinking there's a gnat around them. Agitated, of course, the state of being excited, restless, or troubled. And of course, go back to that 1 through 10 list. You know, when you've gone through loss like that, you can understand. And here again, you know, our residents have been wounded by life that has happened to them. And you probably heard the term, like if somebody has a really bad scratch on their arm or a really bad sore, they'll talk about like that wound looks angry, or that wound is angry. And what they mean is it's inflamed, it's swollen, it's red, it's infected, it has drainage. And you know, that's a wound can be angry, or a wound is angry. And emotional wounds, a lot of time, precipitate the person to be angry. Alzheimer's, of course, we talked about that progressive disease, irreversible. And it's just a progressive, increasing progressive forgetting. When we talked about, you know, when we talk about a person being alert and oriented, alert just means awake. And then oriented to person, time, and place. So when we chart somebody, we chart AO times 3, alert and oriented times 3. So if you ask them what time it is, they can answer you correctly. Place, yeah, they don't say they're in California, they tell you they're Paola, Kansas, and so person, place, and time. Those areas that they answer your questions correctly. And Alzheimer's is that progressive forgetting. Time is usually in the stage one, where they'll forget an appointment, they had something to do today, you know, they had whatever. Okay, and then in stage two, it goes on to place. People will drive off from their home to go to one part of town, and they'll end up in a town 30 miles away. They got lost. In stage two, forgetful to place, they'll even can't find their own bathroom in their own house. And then, of course, person is stage three, when they look right at their spouse. Who are you? Look right out at a child or a grandchild. Who are you? And then, of course, stage four, that's when the body forgets how to operate. Swallowing, forget how to do that, so you know it's going to happen. The gut forgets how to break down food, how to metabolize it, how to absorb it, so you can imagine what's going to happen there, those six vital nutrients. Because the gut's supposed to break them down and absorb them, and it forgets how to do it, malnutrition, dehydration. And then, of course, what a lot of times happens toward the very end is the immune system forgets how to work. So that's why a person can just, most of them get pneumonia and die because of complications, yeah?
With people with Alzheimer's disease, if they know that they're going to get to that stage, don't they, right on the first stage, try to get them to, make some kind of living will to be like, don't let me suffer through that?
Yeah. A lot of folks do now. They didn't used to. There's been a lot of increased education about living wills, about advanced care health directives, you know, now, that in the past there wasn't. And if there wasn't, the state basically said, this not Kansas, when I say the state, I mean California, whatever they're in, said everything has to be done, you know? That's why, see, years ago, there was a big difference from Missouri and Kansas. There were, because Missouri had a certain stand on death and dying that was different than Kansas death and dying interpretations and standards. And there were people that moved from Missouri to Kansas because they didn't want certain things to prolong their life. But in a Missouri nursing home, if they didn't have all this paperwork, they it was like implied consent almost, where they had to get IVs, where they had to get a feeding tube, and had to be sustained. Well, Kansas, if they didn't have a living will, advanced care health directive, totally done yet, was just still honoring their request. So we had people from Missouri nursing homes that moved to Kansas nursing homes. But now, because of all these documents, yeah, we know what to do. You know, we know if they want CPR and don't want CPR. And that, to me, is a big relief. You know, if somebody's DNR and they go down, they crash on you, it's not the time to be wondering, what do I do, what do I do, do I start, do I not start? Because if I'm supposed to start, I'm wasting seconds. And seconds mean a lot in a course of a code. So, but a lot of them do. Now, basically, okay, has anybody been in the hospital in the last year? Uh-huh. Were you asked during the admission process if you had a living will or not? Or an advanced care health director?
No, I thought you just meant to go visit. My daughter was
patient.
She wasn't, but that was.
You were you asked?
Yeah.
Yeah, so now basically everybody's being asked in the hospitals, the nursing home, whatever, they're in the admission process, they are being asked, do you have one? And if they say no, if they say yes, may we have a copy, of course. And if they say no, do you want one? So, you know, the change has been very positive.
My
so now,
when he had just local.
Uh-huh, yeah. And I think also it's not that strange for them to also to ask in the admission process in the hospital, not so much in the nursing home, the hospital, is do you want to donate organs? For a while it was mandated. It's still maybe, I just don't know. I don't keep up on hospital stuff.
They asked me that in 2008 in January when I had my baby.
Yeah.
If I won the living will.
Yeah. So good. So they've been doing it for a while, and so that's good. So a lot of this prolonged suffering doesn't happen much. Okay, bipolar, of course, that's the alternating mood swings of severe depression, alternating with severe ecstasy almost, or cheerfulness, or just, you know, huge mood swings where one day the person loves everybody, they're almost giving all their, they love so much people, they're almost giving all their personal property away, and then as it cycles down, they become very depressive. The brain, that is, the central nervous system is the main computer. Burnout is physical, mental exhaustion. Cataract, of course, that is that cloudiness that can happen in the eye, that can literally blind somebody. It happens so slow, a lot of people don't know they even have them. Catastrophic reaction, of course, that is where a person has a very exaggerated, unreasonable reaction to something for no apparent reason. It's kind of like a volcano where the person will just erupt. One day we had a lady that was trying to give away all her knickknacks. They were old, they were cracked, they were yellow. Most of them had fallen off her shelf so many times. They had been glued 5-6 times back together. So, you know, you can imagine they didn't look very good. Well, she just wanted to get rid of them. Nobody really wanted them. So what she did was she put them in her trash. She was throwing them away. They just didn't look good anymore. She didn't want to look at them anymore. Well, the housekeeper that came in didn't know that she'd thrown them away in the trash. She took them out of the trash and put, there were two, I think. She put them back on her shelf, not knowing that. And the next day, a housekeeper came in while they were mopping with the mop handle, hit one of them off the shelf, and it broke. The lady went into hysterics. She was just throwing it away herself the day before, trying to give it away. But when it broke, she just went into hysterics, screaming. Just unbelievable. That was like a catastrophic reaction. There was another reason for that manifestation. We never found out what it was,
maybe,
but something
triggered. Someone put it back.
I don't know, but something triggered. You know, she knew it was there. She saw it because she was trying to get people to take it again.
Oh, sure.
But it was when it broke again. She just, and so that triggered something else, a memory of something, a past event. Something had to be triggered, and that's a catastrophic reaction. That's where you're going to be with the resident, and they're going to say something, they're going to do something to you, and you're going to stand there and go, where did that come from? What did I do to deserve that? And that is like a catastrophic reaction. Central nervous system, you know, the portion of the nervous system controls, you know, the brain, spinal cord, made up of cerebrovascular accident. Of course, that's the stroke caused by a lack of blood supply in the brain. Remember, wherever the person has the stroke, wherever the brain is damaged, you know, it could be damaged, you know, different on different people. Some people will have a stroke and they'll lose their speech. You know, I always used to think, before I went to nursing school, everybody that had a stroke was either right side or left side. Well, those are the major hemispherical strokes, where if they have a big one on the right, they lose their left side and vice versa. But some people may have it in a certain part of their brain and all they lose sight is in left eye. But no hand changes, no feet changes, no leg changes. Some people have a stroke, all they lose is their speech. So it depends on, in the brain, where the stroke happened at, to what damage, to how basically it is affected. Cognition, that's the ability of a person to think clearly. Contusion, a head injury, delirium. Now, when we talk about dementia and delirium, dementia is your Alzheimer's, is your long-term, is your chronic, no cure. Delirium, on the other hand, is different. It's a sudden onset that has a root cause. Fever, pain, not getting enough sleep, not getting enough oxygen to the brain. So in delirium, or infection, definitely infection. So if delirium, if the root cause can get cleared up, a lot of times so can the confusion. Delusion, believing something's not true. Dementia, we've talked about that. Disruptive behavior, well, right there in the word, it's got the definition. Elopement, of course, is a resident trying to elope, trying to run away, trying to leave the building. And a lot of time in their confusion, you know, a lot of the folks live in the past. You know, when we talk about the good old days, they live in the 1950s, the 1960s, the 1940s, whatever. Because those were the days when they didn't have pain. Those were the days when they had a job still, when they had family, their spouse was still there. And sometimes people will basically wish those days back so much, they will actually live in those days. And of course, that's a lot of times the cause for elopement. They're trying to get back to their house. They're trying to get back to their family. You know, we've had residents before, you know, they're in the nursing home, and the new nurses have killed my daughter. You killed my son. Because if they knew I was in here, they'd come and get me. They're not coming to get me. They're not coming to rescue me. You know, so they try to elope. Epilepsy, of course, is seizure, farsightedness, general anxiety disorder, glaucoma, that's the pressure building up in the eye. We talked about that, where the old fluid doesn't drain out and the new fluid just comes in and still continues to produce, and the pressures go high. Hallucinations is seeing or hearing things that aren't real. Hearing aid, you know what that is. Hoarding, we talked about that the other day. If somebody collects a lot of stuff, those are their treasures. We used to just pull empty out their drawers. You know, take the 50 teaspoons back or get the 50 packets of sugar out of the drawer. But when we started thinking as well what that did to those people, we thought maybe we just better take half of them, you know, and kind of just rotate them through, because those were like their treasures. They were guarded things. Intervention, irreversible, mental health, mental illness. You can read all these, multiple sclerosis. Nearsighted neuron. Neuron is the basic cell unit of the nervous system. Obsessive compulsive behavior disorder, repetitive behavior. Hand washing, a lot of people, you know, they wash their hands a lot. Pacing, walking back and forth. Now sometimes pacing can be in a clue that they're getting ready to elope. Now, some of the clues are obvious. Somebody comes to you and says, hey, tell the kitchen they don't have to cook supper for me tonight. Mm-hmm. Or what time does the bus stop out here? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, those are obvious that they're thinking about elopement. Some of the time, you know, or they're packing their bags. You know, they're going there and they're all on their bed, you know. Those are pretty obvious. Sometimes they're not so obvious. But pacing is one of those that's not so obvious, but it can be a clue. Panic disorder, of course, is an anxiety disorder, causes repetitive episodes of fear. Paranoid schizophrenia, a form of mental illness characterized by hallucinations and delusions. Paraplegia, of course, is that loss of function of the lower part of the legs. Quadriplegic, of course, quad meaning four. It is loss of arms and legs. Parkinson's disease, progressive disease that causes a portion of the brain to degenerate, causes rigid muscles, stiff shuffling gait, tremors, a lot of tremors. You know, your Parkinson's folks are the ones that are going to take their coffee cup and shake so much they're going to spill it. So those sippy cups, you know, would probably be the best for them.
Do they really call them sippy cups?
Huh? I think so. Mm-hmm. Because they just take sips.
Well, Shannon, they won't call the Depends diapers, but they call the sippy cups too.
Yeah, I think they still do. I think they call them sippy cups, and because of that's the action, the sipping action. Pillaging, post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, I haven't seen a lot of folks with this. You guys are going to be the ones who are in nursing the next 20, 30 years. You probably will. You know, a thunderstorm is going to happen, and because pretty soon the guys from Korea and Vietnam are going to be coming in to our nursing homes, and a thunderstorm and a crash of lightning is going to send them to the floor, or is going to do something, you know, whatever their reaction is. And it could be anger. They could think very much that they're back in battle. I know somebody very well that almost came seconds away from killing a respiratory therapist at KU, because the respiratory therapy was from Russia and had a very, very strong Russian brogue. And this person was coming out of surgery, and of course, I don't know if you ever had surgery, but it's kind of hazy, and the room looked blocked to him, they said. It looked weird, and they had tubes, they were tied down, they were cut, they were bleeding, they saw that, and all of a sudden they hear a Russian. And if it hadn't have been for their wife, they would have killed the person. And I know it because it was me. You know, I was looking at my arm bleeding here, I was tied down, and so these are the folks that you guys are going to be basically taking care of. So, like I said, a thunderstorm or a crash of lightning can bring back all these memories, and and post-traumatic stress is real. Progressive quadriplegic, we already talked about that. Loss of function of the arms and the legs. Reality orientation. Remember the lady I told you about that came to the nurse's station, I want my mommy? And then she started screaming when she found out that her mommy was dead. Remember that story? Mm-hmm. You know, okay. Reality orientation is a series of questions that we ask somebody that they answer, that we bring them back to reality. Like, let's just say this is a red plant, and the resident says there's a fire over there. Well, the series of questions would be, George, if it's a fire, wouldn't it feel hot? Does it feel hot to you, George? No. Wouldn't it make noises, crackling sounds? Do you hear anything? Well, no, I don't. So see, through questions like that, George himself is answering his own, and then Vi comes to say, oh, it's not a fire. Okay, it's not a fire. So that is like reality orientation. Well, this lady came to the nurse station one day and asked, where's my mommy? Well, the nurse did the correct thing, did reality orientation. And of course, if she's 88 years old, where's her mommy, you know? Now, hindsight's always 20/20, right? We know that. If she was asking for her mommy, that kind of should have been a clue to us, you know, that she was a little girl again, you know? And I was back in the office working and heard this huge scream when she came to the reality that her mother must be dead, her mother's gone. So reality orientation has changed to what is now mirror their behavior. So we mirror what they're doing, you know? So if they are back in, like, the movie that I saw on it was basically this. A man was standing at the window, looking outside, and he turned around to the nurse as she came in and said, man, it's cold outside, snow and icy, it's gonna be really hard to deliver the mail today. And she answered back, you're right, it is gonna be hard, it is gonna be a tough day. We better dress warm and start out with a good breakfast. So let me help you get dressed here. Let me help you down to breakfast so you can get a real good breakfast. That she was mirroring what he was doing. And so the reality orientation pendulum is swung to mirror. Now, will it swing back again? It may, to reality orientation. But for the most part, right now, we are mirroring, you know, their behavior. Reminiscence therapy, a therapy that encourages people with Alzheimer's disease to talk about the past. And again, a lot of people just do it on their own. Because when they mean the good old days, they're really serious about that. That's when they weren't hurting, when they still had jobs, when their family was still around. Remotivation therapy, you can read these things, rummaging, schizophrenia, social anxiety, spinal cord, substance abuse, sundowning. Sundowning, now just because I skipped these words doesn't mean they might not be on the test, okay? I'm just talking about words I like, okay? Sundowning, of course, is a very interesting phenomenon that a lot of people will be alert and oriented through the day, and the sun goes down, they start to get confused. There's a whole bunch of different theories why. I personally think it's a combination of everything I'm about to tell you.